Sean. I want to know more about mulled coins. What are they? And are they a legitimate error? Can I find one and change? And what's the difference between a mulled pairing compared to, say, a coin struck on another coin? I think we could do that. I think we can make that happen for you guys.
And talk about it I shall. And I tell you what, boys and girls, the Mint had done screwed up on this one. So we're going to talk about the most famous of all mule coins in U.S. history, and it is indeed the 2000 sack dollar muled with a statehood quarter obverse. Okay, we've seen this before. It's in publications. It's all over the internet. It was in the news at one point. It's all over the place. And I'm telling you what, this coin right here has a heck of a story. And I'm going to try and piece together a little bit the best that I can, so that way it's going to be new information for you guys. Because this has been talked about before. You know, we've seen videos and heard about videos from some of my counterparts on YouTube talking about the mule sack dollar. And some have even gone out to say that these are searchable in coin rolls and in pocket change. Okay, now, but before we go into kind of throwing stones at these folks, okay, I am going to genuinely say, based off of the research that I have done on this particular coin, I'm going to tell you why that could be the case. Okay, it's gonna make your head spin like Ichabod Crane, but you know, keep it together, because the information I'm about to share with you is pretty interesting, really, really interesting. So before we get into how many of these exist today, all right, it's important to know why this was even produced. Why does this particular coin even exist in the folklore of American U.S. coinage errors? So, in the year 2000, when they were producing these, the U.S. Mint rather, someone, like I said at the beginning of the video, had done screwed up, boy. Why you gotta be doing that? Why you gotta be taking two different dies, putting them together, and cranking out a bunch of $100,000 coins? yeah, right? This is kind of the error, or the circulating rarity that I'm wishing that the U.S. Mint would produce today. It would make everybody's head spin. But yeah, this is a royal screw up. So someone, as a matter of fact, before Mint officials caught the boo boo in all of this, get this, the U.S. Mint, and this is, by the way, confirmed by U.S. Mint personnel as being the case, 350,000 of these coins were produced at the time of the supposed screw up. Okay, I got other choice words because this is pretty amazing. So 350,000 pieces were produced. A lot of them were tracked down and subsequently destroyed. Okay, I say a lot of them. I didn't say 100% of them were tracked down and subsequently destroyed. They were attempting to find every single piece. And before they had the opportunity, they even went to the Federal Reserve. They tracked them down at banks. Okay, I mean, the paper trail was strong when they were trying to get this. It's not 2019 strong, of course, but you can imagine all the resources that they were leveraging, okay, to make sure that none of these got out to the public. Well, apparently that wasn't the case. A handful of them did, in fact, escape, okay? By the time the Mint officials were to that very last leg of this treasure hunt of theirs, some of these had already made it into the hands of the American public. There was even an example, because right now, like I said, there's 18 pieces of this coin in the census. And when I mean census, they've been documented and certified through NGC or PCGS. Now, the big stink with this particular coin way back when was, you know what, the U.S. government could have confiscated these coins, okay? But it wasn't until fall later that year that they've decided, you know what, we're not going to take these coins away. We're going to let these folks that found them keep them, and then we're just going to move on. And it's going to make a great story to tell. You know, it's interesting because in certain cases, okay, they'll want to take back a 1933 gold St. Gaudens $20 gold piece, but they won't take this away. But they'll take away the 1974 aluminum cent, but they won't take these away. But I don't know the circumstances revolving around the policies and procedures, the SOPs, the standard operating procedures when it comes to coins like this. But anyways, they let these people have them. So 18 exist. There is one guy trying to corner the market, okay? Out of the 18 examples graded and known today, a gentleman by the name of Tommy Bolak owns all but three examples. And he knows exactly who owns the other three examples. So at the time of the most recent discovery, which by the way was in December 2018, He actually owns the 18th example, by the way, the one that just went to auction a short while ago. The U.S. Mint used three different die pairings, which sounds about right for the amount of coinage that was leaked. 350,000 freaking pieces of these things. Three different die pairings, okay, and that could all be, you know, verified via, you know, a certain die markers. So they do know that. The one of the examples that Mr. Bolak does not own happens to be the Greg Sensky example. Let me tell you a little bit about this. It's kind of interesting. So his example is an NGC Mint State 67. Okay, it's absolute beauty. I would imagine it was probably new when he acquired it, and the way he acquired it was kind of interesting. These are things that we kind of, you know, think about and kind of dream for. But this particular example, the Sensky example, was found September in 2000. So it was later in the fall after the Mint had given everybody the previous kind of, like, you know, owners of the few examples that did exist, the blessings that they could keep it. So Mr. Sensky received his example through change at his company's cafeteria in Missouri. Yeah, pretty awesome, huh? Kind of reminds me of the 1955 double die Lincoln cent. Okay, I think Q. David Bowers did a little thing on that about how that particular coin, he found out that some of the earliest discoveries were in a cigarette machine as it gave back change. And how, you know, how they gave back change was they'll just cellophane wrap the change right along with a pack of smokes. So, you know, it's kind of interesting how these things get out, you know, the stories that's wrapped up with certain kind of notable errors and provenances. But this one right here, definitely cool. So, you know, the story revolving around this one is interesting. You know, a mule is simply a coin that was struck with two separate dies. Okay, traditionally there could be two dies of different denominations. You know, a quarter nickel, Sacagawea dollar with a quarter dollar. And how about this next one? Okay, this coin right here, this is actually one of the earliest documented pieces of a mule. And it's a 1995... Roosevelt dime that is muled with a Lincoln cent obverse. How cool is this? So this example right here is probably one of your lesser known mules, okay? Because in most part, the sack dollar mule overshadows everything else, okay? But believe it or not, these other kind of like one-off unique pieces are worth quite a bit more, and you'll see that here in a second. So the Sacagawea mule that you saw at the beginning here, that one sold on Heritage Auctions January 10th of 2013. All right, and that one sold for $88,125. So that's a lot of money right there. This one right here, this 1995 dime with the Lincoln Scent obverse mule pairing, this one sold in January 7th, 2010, and this one garnered $57,500. Now, it doesn't seem like a whole lot compared to the Sac Dollar Mule. You know, if you think about, oh, maybe there's only one or two of that, should be worth more, right? Could be. But you'll have to see the next coin to find out. So that one was an NGC Mint State 64. That one's absolutely nutsoid right there. But the this other mule that I want to also talk about, okay, is kind of similar to the mule that you just looked at. And this is a 1999 Lincoln Scent that is muled with a Roosevelt dime reverse, okay? This one is crazy. It's a PCGS Mint State 66 Red. Okay, you know, these things happen the same way. All right, two different types of dyes, different denominations, muled together to create what you see here. This one sold April 29th of 2006. It's hard to believe it's been 13 years since this one made its one and only auction appearance through Heritage Auctions. This example sold for $138,000. Ooh, yeah, that's crazy. I would venture to guess that every single one of these coins, you could possibly find these in change, all right? Someone did find one getting back change out of a cafeteria, then obviously some of these other ones, you know, are well within the realm of possibility. But it just goes to show you that you never take your eyes off the ball. You look at every single dime, every single penny, and make sure you know exactly what you're looking at. So we have the mules, and someone had mentioned through an email that, hey, you know what? What's the difference between a mule and another coin that is struck over a different coin? Okay, now that sounds kind of confusing, but this picture, this image right here will help help describe and illustrate exactly what what we're talking about. So what we have here is a 2000 Philadelphia Sacagawea dollar. Okay, that was struck over a 2000 Philadelphia Massachusetts quarter. So the difference is the quarter had already been struck. Okay, so it's a fully furnished, completed piece that somehow, some way made it back into a batch of blank sack dollar planchets. All right, and then, you know, just through the process of getting these things minted, it was sorted into the actual minting chamber, it was struck, and then there you go, you have a coin that is a tremendous error. All right, that is not a mule, but it is simply a coin struck over another completed coin. So there's no, that we're not talking about two different dies. We're talking about two different coins struck at this point. So this one right here had seen its day out in regular everyday transactions. Okay, this one has been used a few times. It's obvious because of the grade. This one is a PCGS Mint State 63 example. So it's not a gem by any means. You know, it could spend a little time in pocket change, and based off of the images provided by Heritage Auctions, this one certainly looks the case. Okay, this is a true blue pocket change discovery right here. So this one sold April 28th of 2017, again on Heritage, for the princely sum of $8,812.50. And there you have it. A quick little ditty on muled coins that I think you guys will appreciate. It's a little bit more comprehensive than what I'm used to sharing and probably what you're used to hearing. But it's pretty interesting to note that this they made an absolute boatload of these things before they kind of pump the brakes a little bit and say, oh, whoa, these weren't supposed to happen. Let's track them all down. But in the course of producing, you know, that that run, that 350,000 piece run. I took, you know, more than a day. Okay, it was probably a week's worth of coins right there, and you know, by the time it's all said and done, some of them had escaped. But good on the Mint for allowing these to stay in collectors' hands. And best of luck to Mr. Tommy Bolak as he tries to acquire every single example of the Sacagawea Dollar Mule. He has spent hundreds of thousands of dollars in his quest to perfection. Because if you're going to quarter the market, hey, why not do it on, you know, the top, one of the top coins in U.S. history? Crazy, crazy sauce. But anyways, I want to thank everyone for joining in. Thank you guys for the views. That's the best donation you could do. Support my channel. Hit the like button. Share. Subscribe. Would love to hear you guys' feedback on this one. It's crazy that this coin was possibly, you know, one of the penultimate errors that you can find in change. Okay, I don't normally say that about all coins, but this one right here, a coin that obviously was a major mint F-up, turns out that, you know, they did produce a massive number of these. This was not just some little, you know, oh yeah, let's go ahead and experiment with a couple dies. Hey, oh hey, let's throw in a foreign planchet while we're at it of a coin, you know, like a Spanish real. I don't know. But they really did screw up. This was a major minting malfunction on their part. But it gives us a great story to talk about in coin collecting and numismatics in general. So thank you guys for joining. Hope you guys appreciate this video. I know you guys always do. And I'll check you back out on the next one. All right. You guys take care and keep searching.